I don't really have any way to fix that right now. I mean, I can try. Okay, you can hear it?
Yep, audio's good. Audio's fine.
Okay. All right. Thanks. All right, sounds good now. Now I got to figure out where in the world I was at with everything and how to get all that back. So you'll have to give me a second here to get that figured out. It'll take a while for folks to get back on, unfortunately. But we'll do what we can. Hey, Misty, how are you? You and the alias Cornell. Let's see. Let me go to here. Let me go to here. There you go. Now you can see over here, so you don't have to see my ugly mug up front that close. And then we'll work on this right here. Oh, I wanted to show you something. This is what I wanted to show you. Let's see if I can find where I was at. I think it was that one right there. I wanted to show you this here. I am so, like, my bearings are not straight right now, so you're just going to have to bear with me here as I figure everything out, because I'm a little, like, perturbed. But I have had, let me tell you, I have had an interesting time, and I'm not complaining either. God is good to me and takes care of me. Thursday, I was plowing, snow blowing my driveway, and my ignition, I went to go out, I was going to study all day, and I went to go out, and my ignition on my John Deere went bad, so I had to order one of those. So I'm doing this series on the King James Bible, and then on Saturday night, at 10 p.m. at night, my wife hears this sound from the basement. That's the alarm on my septic that my septic pump is not working right. So I was up until about 1 o'clock in the morning early Sunday morning trying to fix my septic, and I couldn't fix it. I've got to replace the septic pump. Well, probably just the float, but maybe the pump too. So I got to get that taken care of. We got to fix that. I don't want to pay a guy to come out and do it if I don't have to. So another brother and I are going to try to do it here, because it really isn't too difficult. It's just really a lot of things at once here. But anyway, so a little challenging here. And then my technical difficulties comes in here. What in the world is that? Somebody washing their hair. Anyway, but oh, we had 3 weeks ago or 4 weeks ago, we finished up the, about a month ago, we finished up the, what was that called? The hydrant. We had to put a new hydrant in. They didn't put a shutoff in my building when they built this building out here. They didn't put a shutoff here because the next door neighbor actually owned this building. And then he sold this building and the land, the land that we're on. And so before there was a house here, so then we had to dig down 7 feet down below the ground, and then we had to put the new thing in, so put the new hydrant in, and all that good stuff, so there we go. That's what I want to see. I don't want to see some lady in a stupid bikini. I'm so sick and tired. You know, they must really think that we're just a bunch of knuckle dragging, tongue wagging, porn loving people out here, that every single time you look at something, they got to try to show you pornography and everything, or they got to show you some woman scandalously dressed every single time. I mean, I can be looking at spaghetti and they got some tramp on there, half dressed with her cleavage hanging out. I'm like, I'm looking at spaghetti sauce. I don't really care about that. It's just, it's annoying. It's, I hate it so much. It's worse on Windows, because I absolutely hate Windows. It's about the dumbest thing in the world. But anyway, that's the way it goes. But it's like they got to put the biggest bunch of perversion in front of you no matter where you turn. And it's just, it's frustrating. I hate it. It's not frustrating because I desire it. It's frustrating because I'm sick of seeing it. It's annoying. It's just, it's stupid. It's like you're a bunch of, it's like they think everybody's a bunch of sexually driven maniacs that have to have, that they want to sell you their perversion. That's what they do when they take over a country. That's exactly what they do. They want to pump this stuff in front of your face all the time. And I hate it. I absolutely hate it. Like, some of us are actually God-fearing people that we don't want to see your garbage. And we're actually grown men. I'm 46 years old. I'm not some dumb knuckle-dragging, testosterone-driven guy that's completely obsessed with a sexualized society. I really don't want to see it. I really don't care. It's like, it's pizza sauce, people. You look at a dictionary and they think, oh, I think I'll show you this. Stupid. No wonder why we have such a foolish society now. Immature. Just ridiculous. Just immature society. All right, anyway, we'll try this again. Hello, Bices. Melissa Isaiah 61, Beauty for Ashes. Georgia GMC checking in. I know that guy. Well, anyway, you pray for us. I'm not complaining about that stuff. I'm just telling you kind of some of the things that I'm dealing with right now, trying to, you know, but that's all of us have things we deal with. So, you know, I'm not any different than any of you. Now I got to find my Oh Christmas Tree song. I had it. I'm going to use that today here. Where's that guy at? That Pavarotti wannabe. Well, Misty, what you see is what you get. I don't hide anything. I'm not a different guy. I'm the same guy. If you came here and visited this church, is the same guy as you hear online. If you visited my home and you were sitting here in my home with me, you'd see the same guy. So, from that standpoint, anyway, it's just real. Let's see. I'm trying to find. We can listen to his version. Probably it won't matter. But anyway, I'm not going to talk about Santa Claus today, really. But what I wanted to do is show you this. Because I was looking at Manly P. Hall's Secret Teachings of All Ages. I wanted to see what he had to say about evergreen trees and a few other things, just to brush up on a few extra things, okay? Is Carl gone? I don't think I didn't I didn't kick Carl out, so I don't know what's going on. But this Egyptian god is named Bes. This is the original Santa Claus. This right here is the original Santa Claus. He was a dwarf-like god in Egypt. Okay? And he made presents and dolls and everything for little boys and girls. And they said he miraculously delivered them. I had never seen this before about this. Manly P. Hall talked about it. He's a Mason, high-level Freemason, occultist. Aleister Crowley type occultist, you know, just a wicked man. But he wrote about this little troll god, this little elf god. And this little elf god is who they, he was the original Santa Claus. Made presents, did all those things. I thought that was interesting. I think I have a few things on him, but he said, Manly P. Hall says, among the ancient Egyptians, there was a rotund and amiable deity named Bes, a gnome-like figure who was also regarded as the patron of little children. This god lived with the other deities at the North Pole and is supposed to have labored industriously throughout the year making dolls and toys for the boys and girls who were good and obedient. He could travel invisibly through space and had a wonderful way of knowing the virtues and faults of the children he visited. St. Nicholas seems to have been first adopted officially as the patron of children in the Netherlands. St. Nicholas Eve, the little folks leave their wooden shoes filled with hay for the horses, which the good saint rides. So anyway, this is that original god of the Egyptians. Now, we're going to talk about the Christmas tree. And we're going to answer the question. Should Christians have a Christmas tree? And the answer is no. But I'm going to show you why it's no. I'm going to show you what the Christmas tree is. And here's the thing about that. It never makes anybody happy when you talk about things like this. People don't really like that, right? I wish I knew where the one was that I had already. What was that guy's name? Mario something? Let me look him up and see if I can find him. There we go. Okay. Now, I want you to listen to this song, and then I want you to think, is this biblical? Because here's what people do with this tree. In other sermons, I called it the Baal bush. Boy, did that make a lot of people happy. I remember the first time I talked about that Christmas tree, and oh my goodness, did I make some women mad at me. You'd think I stole their firstborn.
Christmas tree, forever true your color. Oh, Christmas tree, oh, Christmas tree, forever true your color.
Okay, now hang on. Ah! Okay, I'm sorry. All right. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, my God. Why is it seeing? Hold on. Oh, stop. All right. What? I can't help it. I'm trying. Give me a second. Why does it seem so stupid to sing to a tree? Okay, are we back on or what? We'll see if it stayed on. I'm not sure. It just totally kicked me off of OBS. Let me know if you're still on. Goodness. What is the deal with this, man? Oh, it kicked me off of Sermon Audio, too. OBS just kicked me out. Man, I keep having some problems here today. What is the deal? I think I made the devil mad. You better pray for me. Lord, please help us. I should have prayed extra. Lord, please forgive me for not praying before about this at this time. But, man, I'm telling you, I'm getting blocked like you wouldn't believe here. Just goodness, it is just like kicking me out. Okay. Let's see. Let's try it. Let's see if Sermon Audio is back on. Wow, I'm back on Sermon Audio. Okay. Now, I better quit laughing at the Christmas tree. Oh, Christmas tree. I think it's really funny. Sorry. There's this guy like... Here's this guy like laughs eloquently. He's singing. He's like, wait, dude, you're singing to a tree. Yeah, that's kind of weird. All right. Okay.
Your bough so green in summertime. Stay bravely green in wintertime. Oh, Christmas tree. Oh, Christmas tree, forever true your call. Oh, Christmas tree, oh, Christmas tree, how sturdy God hath made thee. Oh, Christmas tree. Oh, Christmas tree, how sturdy God hath.
Mr. Poet once said he wants to marry the tree. Stop. Oh, no one's going to listen. You're all going to like hang up on me. You're like, all right, we're done. All you're doing is laughing. You're not. Saying anything. I can't help it. It's just, it's so stupid to me. Oh, I remember the first time I did this and the look on these ladies' faces and people's faces when I did this, they were like, oh, I remember I had a preacher get mad at me. He's like, I enjoy my tree. If you think we're all a bunch of pagan Tammuz worshipers, that's your fault, brother. I'm like, okay. Okay. Oh, all right. All right. Get your composure. All right. It's time to get serious now. Let's. Here we go. Oh. Here we go. Oh.
Made thee, thou bidst us all place faithfully our trust in God unchangingly. Christmas tree, oh Christmas tree, how sturdy God hath made thee.
Oh my goodness, is that funny? Oh, okay. All right. Okay, now if I can get my composure back here, we're going to learn about the Christmas tree. All right, so should a Christian have a Christmas tree? Well, I don't think Carl's hidden.
Although I know people who would like to hide Carl for a while.
Let's see. I don't think I hit him. I guess I could go to YouTube and look at that. Let me look at it in real time. Is Carl hidden? I guess. Whoa. All right. Let's look at the live stream here. Where in the world is Carl? I'm sorry. It's like, where's Waldo, or where in the world is Carmen Sandiego? Either way, Carl is not here. It says here that Carl is not on this chat.
Are you sure Carl's not taking any of those funny pills?
Okay. All right, I really got to get to this, because if I don't get going here, look, I'm never going to get anything done. Hey, what happened to my Christmas tree? Okay, hang on. There's Carl's buddy, the fake Elvis, right there, but we won't talk about that. We won't talk about Carl's fake Elvis buddy. We are going to move right along here. Okay. All right. So what we are going to go to now is the Christmas tree images. So you don't have to look at the weird YouTube screen. Okay, here we go. Oh, that sounded good. Kind of weird. Here you go. Okay. All right. So, I'm sorry, Carl, but I can't find you. I don't know where you went. But Peter's here. Maybe you have an alter ego. Maybe it's Peter. All right. Now, Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse number 2. Great. Now I got to find my online King James Bible, because all kinds of weird things had to happen today. I don't know what that is either. Now I got to find my online King James Bible. Sorry about the technical difficulties. And my Bible disappeared. Oh, great. All right, there we go. Now we're good. Now we're going to find it. Now we're going to get moving here. Okay, let's move this over here. Move this back up here. Let's move over here. I just want to laugh at that song for another hour, but I got to really get something done. All right. Deuteronomy 12 and verse number 2. You shall utterly destroy all the places wherein the nations which you shall possess serve their gods, upon the high mountains and upon the hills, and under every green tree. Huh. Well, so that means that you got to chop down all your trees. No. You don't have to do that. The difference is that you're saying it's a Christmas tree. that you're using that tree in your worship of the Lord. Right? That's what you're saying. You're saying you're using it in the worship to the Lord. Well, that's not biblical worship. That's pagan worship. Look at this. Look what Jesus said. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit. Therefore, you don't get to worship God the way you want to. You worship God the way he prescribed in the scriptures. And you certainly don't worship him the way you worship, the way men worship heathen gods. You don't do that. Okay? They fancied their gods delighted in, and this notion prevailed among other nations, and there is scarcely any deity by what had some tree or another devoted to it, as the oak to Jupiter, the laurel to Apollo, the ivy to Bacchus, the olive to Minerva, the myrtle to Venus. Under every green tree. Doesn't matter what you like. That is irrelevant. Well, I like it. I like having it. I like it. It's fun. Doesn't matter if you like it. Is it wrong? Is it right? Is it biblical worship? Let's go to 1 Kings. See a pattern here of people worshiping with green trees, having religious ceremonies. Since Christmas, you'll say, is all about Jesus. That's what they say. Right? So let's look at 1 Kings chapter 14. Right? 1 Kings chapter 14. And verse number 23. For they also built them high places and images and groves on every high hill and under every green tree. Hey, let's throw this in. And there were also Sodomites in the land, and they did according to all the abominations of the nations which the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. Huh. Okay. That was weird. What are those guys doing there with every green tree? Oh, that's 2 Kings I'm looking for, not 1 Kings. 2 Kings... 2 Kings, chapter 16. And he sacrificed and burnt incense in the high places and on the hills and under every green tree. Nah. That about it anyway. It's weird. 2 Kings, chapter 17. Are you starting to see a pattern here? No, that's not a Christmas tree, you big loser. What's the matter with you? Everybody knows Jeremiah's not talking about a Christmas tree. You didn't see a Christmas tree in that verse. What's the matter with you, you big loser? Doesn't say Christmas tree. Okay. Well, have you ever thought about using, like, common sense? Like, if what you're doing is described in Jeremiah chapter 10, might be a good indication you're doing the same things. But we'll get to that in a second. Ah, 2 Kings chapter 17, verse number 10. We've already looked at that. Let's go on to Isaiah chapter 57, verse number 5. Are you following along, class? Carl's mad because he can't talk, and I'm over here like, amen. Amen. Carl's got to take notes, and he's got to sit behind the computer. How about this? Inflaming yourselves with idols under every green tree. Slaying the children of the valleys under the cliffs of the rocks. Okay, well, that's weird. There's that green tree thing again. What's going on with that anyway? And how come, hey, you suppose it's kind of weird that, like, every time that green tree is mentioned, they're a bunch of pagans? You think that's kind of weird? Right? You think it's kind of weird? Yeah, it's a little bit weird, isn't it? Okay. Isaiah chapter 57, verse number 5. See there? How about Jeremiah chapter 2, verse number 20? For of old time I have broken thy yoke and burst thy bands, and thou saidest, I will not transgress. When upon every high hill and under every green tree thou wanderest playing the harlot. Ah. Well, let's get a little more serious now. God's calling them a bunch of spiritual harlots. Well, also they are physical harlots too. Do you know what the pagans did with these underneath the green trees? Yeah. You guessed it. That's what they did. Okay. Jeremiah chapter 3. And the Lord said also unto me in the days of Josiah the king, hast thou seen that which backsliding Israel hath done? She has gone up upon every high mountain and under every green tree, and there hath played the harlot. It says backsliders use those green trees. Steve Dirtling says, with Jesus, there's a new covenant. He conquered death and the old. You're just being superstitious. Yeah. You know what's funny about that? Let me translate what you just said. And I know you're probably playing, but let me translate what you just said. Are you ready? What you just said is, hey, Jesus died so I could be a pagan. Jesus died so I could practice paganism. Leave me alone, you legalist loser. Jesus died so I could be a pagan. That's why he died. He died so I could practice paganism. Yeah, that's weird. Right? Oh, okay, I get it. It's cool. That's what I'm supposed to do. Gotcha. Okay. I mean, because I wouldn't at all. I can see you, Carl Winters. You're orange. Like Orange Man. You are like the Phoenix Rising. Okay. Jeremiah chapter 3, verse number 13. Look at this. Only acknowledge thine iniquity that thou hast transgressed against the Lord thy God and hast scattered thy ways to the strangers under every green tree, and ye have not obeyed my voice, saith the Lord. That doesn't sound good, does it? That sounds kind of bad. I think that sounds like one of those things like, hey, you're not supposed to do that. You better quit that. Stop it. Jeremiah 17. Verse 2. Whilst their children remember their altars and their groves by the green trees upon the high hills. Ah. That's weird. Okay. Ezekiel 6:13. Then shall you know that I am the Lord, when their slain men shall be among their idols round about their altars, and upon every high hill, in all the tops of the mountains, and under every green tree, and under every thick oak, the place where they did offer a sweet savor to all their idols. Well, that's Ezekiel 6. Ezekiel 17. Ezekiel 17, verse number 24. That's my daughter hiding from the camera. Ezekiel chapter 17, verse number 24. And all the trees of the field shall know that I, the Lord, have brought down the high tree, have exalted the low tree, have dried up the green tree, and have made the dry tree to flourish. I, the Lord, have spoken and done it. Ezekiel 20, verse number 47. And say to the forests of the south, hear the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord God, behold, I will kindle a fire in thee, and shall devour every green tree in thee, and every dry tree, and the flame that flaming flame shall not be quenched, and all the faces from the south to the north shall be burned therein. Now God is giving an example. He say it's a message for man. He's not really speaking to a tree, because a tree doesn't answer. But what he's saying is that I'm gonna burn all this up. That's what I'm going to do with it. I'm going to burn it all up. Luke 23:31. For if they do these things in a green tree, what shall be done in the dry? That's a good question, isn't it? Now, let's look at the infamous verse. Are you ready for the infamous verse? Jeremiah 10. I forgot where Jeremiah was. What's wrong with my head today? I don't know. It's Monday. I just can't think straight on Monday. Sometimes I am just not with it. Sometimes on Monday, I've been distracted by 1,000 different things, of course. Okay, anyway. Now, here's what we're going to do, kids. We're going to, I want to preface this with like every other thing that everybody says. That's not a Christmas tree. That doesn't say Christmas tree. That's not a Christmas tree. And then when you say that to them, it's like in their mind, here's what they do. Here's what happens to them in their mind when you do that, right? This is what happens in their mind. Right. Here's what happens in their mind. They literally go off like they lose it, and then this is all they can think of.
Oh Christmas tree, forever true your color. Christmas tree.
It's like they've been programmed.
Oh, Christmas tree, forever true your color.
So they can't, you know, differentiate they can't have a conversation with you, right, about it, because they lose their mind and they just go into singing about the tree in their brains, and you're just like they're gone. They're gone. Hear ye the word which the Lord speaketh unto you, O house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, learn not the way of the heathen. Now, Let's stop here for a second and understand this. It does not say that you're a heathen. It does not say that this is a Christmas tree. It says, learn not the way of the heathen. Oh. So stop acting like a heathen. Learn not the way of the heathen and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed at them. Why would you do something that was, I mean to tell you, why would you do something like so close to this anyway? For the customs of the people are vain. The customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workman with the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold. Deck the halls with boughs. Sorry. And then they follow la la la, la 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 la. That's what they do. They deck it with silver and with gold. You know what that word means, to deck something? It means to cover it. So they take a tree out of the forest, or their fake one, out of the tree making plant, like George Bush would say. They take a tree out of the tree making plant. What they do. Old Bush said that. We got a problem in America today. I'm going to stop it there. I'm not going to go through that. Anyway. A lot of good docs getting out of business. All right. they deck it with silver and with gold. Nah. That's not a Christmas tree. Sure sounds like one. Sure sounds like one. Doesn't it? Sure sounds like your old fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la, doesn't it? It sounds like it. If it ain't one, it sure sounds like it. Do you want it to be that close? Right? Do you want it to be that close to what you're doing? I sure wouldn't want to get, man, it's like describing it. Well, we're going to go cut our Christmas tree out, and then we're going to bring it into our house, and then we're going to deck it. Ain't that the same thing? Like, where did that custom come from? Well, the Bible shows you where the custom came from. There it is. The Bible showed you where the custom came from. It came from pagans. I'm going to show you historically, too. But the Bible's our authority. It's our final authority. It came from pagans. Right? That's where it came from. Jeremiah talks about it. Jeremiah 3:6, the Lord said unto me in the days of Josiah, we talked about that verse, the high places were used for worship and for trees. So these Israelites were committing spiritual fornication. The Lord said unto me, the backsliding Israel hath justified herself more than treacherous Judah. Go and proclaim these words toward the north, and say, return, thou backsliding Israel, saith the Lord, and I will not cause mine anger to fall upon you. For I am merciful, saith the Lord, and I will not keep anger forever. Only acknowledge thine iniquity, thou hast transgressed against the Lord thy God, and hast scattered thy ways to the strangers under every green tree and have not obeyed my voice, saith the Lord. The example of it is paganism. The green tree was worship. Listen to this. Jesus Christ is called the vine, and we are called the branches. Here's another thing that Manly P. Hall said, I believe, in his Secret Teachings of All Ages. He said this. The Christmas tree is a phallic symbol, just like the obelisk. Every time you decorate the tree, especially when you hang your round little ornaments on it, you're performing a pagan ritual. Now, I'm not going to explain that. Besides, I could explain it as the Masonic Order of Tubal Cain. If you understand that, then you'll understand what I'm saying. That's as far as I'm getting with that. Because this is a family program. Listen to this. Pagans in Europe used branches of evergreen fir trees to decorate their homes and brighten their spirits during the winter solstice. Early Romans used evergreens to decorate their temples at the festivals of Saturnalia, while ancient Egyptians used green palm rushes as part of their worship of the god Ra. One man said, Dominic Wilson said this, the idea of bringing the evergreen into the house represents fertility and new life in the darkness of winter, which was much more of the pagan themes, said Dr. Dominic Wilson from the University of Sydney. Listen to this. Saturn, Manly P. Hall says this. Saturn, the old man who lives at the North Pole and brings with him to the children of men a sprig of evergreen, the Christmas tree, is familiar to the little folks under the name Santa Claus, for he brings each winter the gift of a new year. By the way, the British Druids and the mistletoe. There you go. Where'd that mistletoe teaching come from? Where do they get that from? Well, that's an ancient pagan custom. There's their mistletoe right there. Manly P. Hall, he said he was a Mason, a high-level occultist. He said, we have already mentioned the peculiar veneration in which the mistletoe was held by the British Druids. We are not surprised, therefore, to find that it was descended among the many English customs associated with the Christmas season. The mistletoe is a parasitic plant which attaches itself to trees with great tenacity and generally lives as long as the tree survives. In Germany, the word for mistletoe signified all heal. And the plant was held to possess mystical and magical virtues. The ancients believed that mistletoe was nourished by the air and light and by the rays of the moon. When it was cut, it must never touch the earth or its powers would be destroyed. There has long been a religious symbolism relating to this plant, which may have been derived from the idea that it symbolizes the impermanent relationship between the body and the soul. Like the soul, the mistletoe is attached to a body, but as a separate existence. in space, and it also receives into itself strange energies and forces moving in the air. The presence of the mistletoe in the homes of our ancient forebears was considered as a benediction, and if true lovers stood beneath its branch, it brought good fortune. Here is one of the most beautiful of the old, this is what Manly P. Hall says, of the old Christian Christmas customs. Devoutly religious in its original meaning. It would be no exaggeration to say that to stand under the mistletoe means actually to stand under the wing of the Holy Spirit of life, or to accept the guardianship of the power of the soul. See, then there's also Nimrod's got his Christmas tree. See Nimrod's tree holding the deer. That's Nimrod's tree. See that? Huh, really? Yeah, really. Yeah, really. Yeah. Well, that's kind of weird. Yeah. You see, I don't do that. Hang on a second. I want to copy this. There we go. I put that in over here. I gotta find that here. And here is Manly P. Hall. Here is his story of Christmas. See all the occultic things that Manly P. Hall has? Just the same as Roman Catholicism, by the way. That's kind of weird. The sun god. Mm-hmm. There you go. Okay. Manly P. Hall said, at this season also, the lusty Romans celebrated Saturnalia. As a long and important festival, which terminated on Christmas Eve. In the old calendar, December 25th was marked with the words Natalis Solis Invicti. The birthday of the invincible sun. They called it the birthday of the invisible sun. See this? Probably no special calculation was necessary for everywhere and always, even in the ancestors of the Latins, had kept the birthday of the solar mystery. The solar mystery. This was sufficient to make this time and season unique in spiritual experience of mankind. This festival was always a kindly occasion. Men, either in gratitude or through fear, were motivated to generous and unselfish actions. It was always the worship of gods. For the Saturnalia was their birthday. But the enlightened pagan had already learned that the God-fearing must also be the humanity-loving. Yeah. Here's another thing they did with these green trees. Many pagan cultures used to cut boughs of evergreen trees in December, move them into the home or temple, and decorate them. Modern-day pagans still do. This was to recognize the winter solstice, the time of the year that had the shortest daylight hours and longest night of the year. This occurs actually sometime between December 20th to December 23rd. Most often, it is December 21st. As the solstice approached, they noticed that the days were gradually getting shorter. Many feared that the sun would eventually disappear forever, and everyone would freeze in the dark and starve to death because of the failure of next year's crops. But even though the deciduous trees, bushes, and crops died or hibernated for the winter, the evergreen trees remained green. They seemed to have magical powers that enabled them to withstand the rigors of winter. It's paganism, folks. That's what it is. It isn't anything more than just good, bad, old-fashioned paganism. That's all it is. Right? Not having evergreen trees, the ancient Egyptians considered the palm tree to symbolize resurrection. They decorated their homes with its branches during the winter solstice. The first decorating of an evergreen tree began with the heathen Greeks and their worship of their god Adonai, who allegedly was brought back to life by the serpent. So let's look at this. This is their Greek god, and they never have any clothes on. They're just a bunch of perverts. Anyway. Their Greek god, Adonai, who allegedly was brought back to life by the serpent. Oh. Let's put the serpent's name in. A-E-S-S-U-L... There they are. Oh! Look at that. Makes sense? There he is. That's what brought him back to life. No kidding. A serpent brought him back to life, huh? Well, you know, now you don't hear that every day, do you? Guess not. Guess not. Okay. That was the first decorating of the evergreen tree. It began with the heathen Greeks and their worship of their god. The slain god. Who is the slain god? Osiris. Osiris is the slain god. And the serpent gives life unto the image of the beast. That is Osiris. Now, next we have the first, the ancient pagan Romans decorated their trees with bits of metal and replicas of their god. Bacchus, the fertility god. Oh, huh. Man, that's kind of weird. Well, that'd be kind of weird, wouldn't it? That's the ancient Romans. I was just trying to see if there was a picture of the ancient Romans decorating anything there, right? But they probably wouldn't have anything on that, would they? But the ancient Romans, right? That's what they did. Their fertility god, which I don't want to put a picture of, which is Bacchus, the god of revelry and wine. Not that guy again. They also placed 12 candles on the tree in honor of their sun god. Right? So these candles on the tree is an ancient pagan Roman custom to honor their sun god. Their midwinter festivals of Saturnalia, started on December 17th and often lasted until a few days after the solstice. In Northern Europe, the ancient Germanic people tied fruit and attached candles to every evergreen tree branches in honor of their god Woden. Trees were viewed as symbolizing eternal life. This is the deity after which Woden's Day was named. The trees joined holly, mistletoe, and wassailbowl, and the Yule log as symbols of the season. They all predated Christianity. Do you understand? Do you understand that all these were heathen customs that Christians attached them to, but had nothing to do with their worship to Christ? Nothing. Don't you care? Don't you care if you're not worshiping him according to spirit and truth? Doesn't that matter? Or you just say, I'll do it my own way. Well, God says, learn not the way of the heathen. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, take a tree, pull it out of the forest, deck it, and worship me with it, and put candles on it, or put balls on it, or anything else on it. Put those on it and worship me. Has nothing to do with God. Has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. Druid priests in Great Britain also use evergreen plants and mistletoe in their pagan ceremonies. We talked about that. And the mistletoe plant was a symbol of the birth of a god. So the birth of a god. Celtic druids and Norsemen of Scandinavia also use mistletoe in a mysterious ceremony just after winter solstice. Let's look at that. Celtic druids. Let's see. Let's see. Ritual of the oak and mistletoe. There you go. In which white-clad druids climbed a sacred oak, cut down mistletoe growing on it, sacrificed two white bulls, and used the mistletoe to make an elixir to cure infertility and the effects of poison. The ritual, known from a single passage in Pliny's Natural History, has helped shape the image of the druids into popular imagination. Old Pliny the Elder. Old Greek mystic Gnostic devil. The only extant source for this ritual is passage in Natural History by Roman historian Pliny the Elder. He says, we should not omit to mention that the great admiration that the Gauls have for it as well. The Druids, that is what they call their magicians, hold nothing more sacred than the mistletoe and a tree, on which it is growing, provided it is a hard-timbered oak. Mistletoe is rare, and when found, it is gathered with great ceremony, and particularly on the sixth day of the moon. Hailing the moon in a native word that means healing all things, they prepare ritual sacrifice and banquet beneath a tree and bring up two white bulls whose horns are bound for the first time on this occasion. A priest arrayed in white vestments climbs the tree and with a golden sickle cuts down the mistletoe, which is caught in the white oak. They kill the victims, praying to a god to render his gifts propitious to those on whom he bestowed it. They believe that the mistletoe given in drink will impart fertility to any animal that is barren and that is an antidote to all poisons. Paganism. It's paganism. That's where they get it from. That's where their tree worship and their tree symbolization and they're bringing trees in. It's paganism. That's what it is, friend. That's all it is. In the middle of the 1500s, Germans began to use evergreen trees as a symbol of hope for the coming of spring. This practice is likely to have gradually evolved from pagan rituals of past and merged with the celebration of Christmas, leading to the tree's Christian beginnings. So somewhere along the way in Germany in about the 1500s, they started mingling this together. There are also claims that the first proper Christmas tree was erected in Riga, Latvia, in 1510. Today, there's a plaque in the town hall square in Riga that is engraved with the text, "The First New Year's Tree in Riga, 1510. It is believed that this tree was burned during a New Year's celebration and possibly decorated with paper flowers. However, it seems more likely that this celebration was related more to the Christmas tree's pagan past. The most likely Christian beginnings of the modern Christmas tree were in the mid-1500s in Germany. In 1521, in the region of Alsace, formerly part of Germany, the first pine tree was decorated and used in a Christmas celebration. In 1539, in the Cathedral of Strasbourg, there are church records that state a Christmas tree was used for the Christmas celebration. In 1570, there are reports from Bremen Guild Chronicle that a fir tree was decorated with fruits and nuts, which children ate on Christmas Day. In 1700s, the Christmas tree custom had spread throughout northern Germany, and people began decorating the tree with candles that were lit on Christmas Eve, as is still done today in many homes across Europe. As the Christmas tree custom spread through Germany, the Roman Catholic Church eventually recognized it. In early 1800s, it was introduced to Vienna in 1816, quickly spread across Austria, and in 1840 to France by the Duchess d'Orléans. I believe this is Manly P. Hall here. He says, to fully understand the history of the Christmas tree, one must understand the mystical importance coniferous evergreens held for the pagan Norsemen who inhabited the frigid, often enchanting forests of northern Germany. This era of pre-Christian Germanic history can be characterized as a time as savage as it was beautiful, mystical as it was mysterious, and as warm-hearted as it was cold and bitter in frozen landscape. Pre-Christian pagans inhabited a land that they believed they shared with numerous gods, nature spirits, and demons. A common example was the Norse worship of the oak tree. Its strong and long-burning wood was a sign of the strength of the spirits that inhabited the oak. It was often used as a symbol of the Norse god chieftain Odin. When the seasons turned, however, and winter brought with its numerous evils and malicious spirits stalking the shadows of wintry forests, the pagan people would turn to the aid and magic of any nature spirits that would help them. Plants and trees such as mistletoe, holly, and evergreen, unlike the aforementioned oak tree, were believed to have some special power against the darker magics of winter because they were the only plants that stayed green throughout the year. During the winter, to shore their homes from the malevolent winter spirits, pagan Germanic people would hang wreaths and bushels of evergreens over their doors and windows, believing their spirit was enough to ward off winter evils. In many cases, evergreen decor were brought indoors where their scent could freshen the dark medieval homes of otherwise stagnant straw and thresh. The needles and cones would even be burned as a form of incense, its smoke and fragrance filling the home with protective spirit magic of the evergreen. So watch this. Oops. Here's the roots of wreath. You'll be getting in touch with your pagan roots. It turns out a front door wreath date back thousands of years. The ancient Etruscans, the civilization of the Italian peninsula before the Romans, made wreath crowns of ivy, oak, olive, myrtle, and laurel leaves, as well as wheat and vines. The ancient Greeks were fond of making crowns of laurel leaves for heroes, champions. The custom of hanging the wreath on the front doors of homes stretches across European cultures from the Mediterranean. The ancient Greeks wove white and red woolen threads with vines, wheat, and other important crops to create harvest wreath that became a home amulet, a secret item of protection hung on front doors year-round. From Eastern Europe through Greece and Ukraine in pre-Christian times, many cities had ceremonies involving singing youths sacred wreaths through the streets to temples and harvest wreaths. Often laurel were decorated with harvested fruits and nuts. They were either hung in temples or carried home. Their hanging was followed by feasting and celebrations. The sanctified wreaths were supposed to protect the cities and homes and dwellers against plagues and misfortunes to ensure a good harvest coming. That's what they did. So they use their wreath. Their pagan rituals. See? They admit it. The association between wreaths and eternal life, durability, strength in Europe. Look, make a magical herb wreath. If you use herbs at all in your magical practices, oh. There you go. This is for witches and pagans. There you go. Healing wreath, protection wreath, abundance wreath, love wreath. Don't wait until Valentine's Day to try this. Love should be 24/7. Invite love into your home that by hanging a wreath full of love herbs on your door. Any combination of these will work beautifully. And I recommend using herbs that personally resonate. Now, we know they're a bunch of pagans and they're superstitious. But the point is, it's paganism. It's all paganism. So during the winter, to shore their homes from malevolent winter spirits, in many cases, evergreen decor were brought indoors where they could freshen up the house. The needles and cones would even be burned in a form of incense, its smoke and fragrance filling the home with protective spirit magic of the evergreen. During the winter solstice, when winter was at its darkest and the days were the shortest of the year by Germanic lunar calendar, Celtic and pagan civilizations throughout northern Europe would celebrate and sacrifice to the north god Yule, though pronounced contemporarily recognized as Yule, and celebrate their Yuletide festival. Okay. Right. This is their Yuletide festival. Here you go. Yule most commonly refers to July. Scholars have connected the origin of celebration of Yule to the wild hunt, the god Odin, and pagan Anglo-Saxon Mother's Night. Some present-day Christmas customs and traditions, such as the Yule log, the Yule goat, the Yule boar, the Yule singing, and others, may have connections to older pagan Yule traditions. Indeed, they do. Yule is the modern version of Old Norse god Odin. The Old English derives it from there. 12 days festival of Yule. On the 12th day of Christmas. Isn't that what it is? 12 days of Christmas? Is that what the song is? Now I can't remember. I have to look. Let's see. Oh my goodness, that's what it is! The 12-day festival of Yule! It comes from Woden! Woden's Day! Somebody got mad at me because I talked about this the other day. Somebody got mad today when I talked about this on my or on Facebook. I was commenting on one of the threads. Somebody got mad and they said, "Oh, do you know what day it is? Monday." So that's the moon day. So see, you're pagan too. And I said, "Ha." I said, "No, it's the second day of the week. I'm no loser." That was funny. But look at that. Looks a little pagan to me. While the Old Norse month, bunch of pagans. Well, there you go. There's the Yule. That's what they were doing. And you have the 12 days of Christmas. Christmastide. So, I'm hoping to make lots of friends and influence lots of people. All right. This is the tradition from which we have our Yule log today. The Germanic practice, however, involved cutting down a massive hardwood log that was large enough to burn for 12 days of feasting and sacrifice, and served as a fertility symbol to both help with the coming of spring and prophesy its bounties. That's not weird at all. Stop thinking about that. During the winter solstice, when winter had its strongest influence on the frozen landscape, Norse pagans would, by tradition, bring entire evergreen trees into their homes. No, they wouldn't. That's not a Christmas tree, you loser! That's not a Christmas tree, loser! It's not! Quit calling it that! Oh, I didn't. They just said they brought evergreens into the house. You know, because that's not normal common sense behavior to cut a tree down and stick it in your house. It's weird. Okay. Because I don't every day just like cut evergreens down and stick it in my front room. Where'd that come from? That's Christmas. Merry Christmas. I know. This is why I have no friends. Because I have too much fun doing this. Okay. Hey, remember, it's a broadcast. It's not my sermon on Sunday. I can have fun. I have fun there, too. Okay, Southern Baptists have something called the Singing Christmas Tree Pageant every year, with choir members singing in a giant Christmas tree on the altar. Yeah, that's kind of weird. Anyway. Right, then cutting it down and claiming it's a symbol of everlasting life. Yeah, that makes sense. That's what the pagans do. Yeah, I know. But that ain't a Christmas tree. Christmas tree, silly. Merry Christmas. Okay. All right. It's kind of satanic, just a little bit. You know what? That seems an awful lot like paganism to me. I don't know if you've ever figured that out, but the more I look at that, that sounds like paganism. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, it does. Kind of does. Well, that's what them fellers are saying, too. Them fellers are saying that's paganism. Yeah, I know. They're pagans. They're just telling you what they do. And the Christians are like, but we're not like them. We're not like them. Not the same thing. Oh, Christmas tree. Okay. It is the same thing. And you need to stop it. All right. At least be honest about it. Well, it's pagan, but I love my tree. Okay. Oh. That's weird. What does the Church of Satan and other Levian Satanist groups celebrate Yule as an alternative to the Christian Christmas holiday? Yule and Levian Satanism is not celebrated with the same rituals as in their contemporary paganism or heathenry. Well, what do you think about that? How's that for weird? Look, they all have the same festivals, all these pagans. I just Christianized paganism. It's not hard to do. Constantine did it. Hey, look, brother, if Constantine can Christianize paganism, so can I. Oh, wait. Maybe you're not supposed to do that. Maybe you're not supposed to do that. Constantine did it. Okay. He sure did. Oh my goodness, I'm not done yet. It's 4:00. During the 8th century, missionaries from the Holy Roman Catholic Church began to make their way north to what is now Germany and the Netherlands. One such missionary who would become the saintly bishop of Germany was good old Boniface himself. Boniface. Or some may know him as Boniface. But I prefer Boniface. I think it has a nice ring to it. Boniface. And being just a plain old white guy from the Iowa-Illinois border, Boniface. Boniface is his name. I don't know how much I have left, Carl. Oh my goodness. I have a lot left. I don't want to turn... I might have to turn this into a two-parter. And then I could add some things in for clarity and have a really good time with it, like I have had. You really think, Carl, do you really think a Christmas tree part two would be okay? Do you really think people would like be okay with that? I could add some other things in there. Just call the second part the pagan roots of the Christmas tree. You know, so differentiate from the title. Joe, do you think so? I don't want to be like Elon Musk here and do a Twitter poll. But do you really think so, Joe? Do you really think we can handle another one of these? Because it's already 4:00. Okay, that's 1, 2, 3 votes. All right, I'm going to play a song here. We're going to do the Elon Musk Twitter poll. Let's see. We'll play this one.
Oh, I want to see him and look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. As I journey through this land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, through him I must win. Oh, I want to see him and look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, just let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in valleys low I look toward the mountain height, and behold my Savior there leading in the fight with a tender outstretched hand toward the valley so low, guiding me. I can see as I onward go, when before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my path, he does safely keep, and he leads me gently on through this world below, and he's a real friend to me, oh I love him so, and oh I want to see him, just look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On those streets of glory, just let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
All right, we will do part two on Wednesday, and I'll add some cool things. If you have some, you know, it'd be a good idea also. Man, you know what I did? You know what I might do Friday? Because I should just make this a whole Christmas week. Man, I should go back through this one that I did years ago. Man, Ooh, I might do that. Anyway, we'll see. I think I might. I got some good stuff there. It went through. It was good. And I actually got that. Oh, that's okay. I don't worry about it. I don't worry about it. I don't argue. I don't go on other people's posts and argue on it. Because
you're a mean one, Mr. Cooley.
I'm just the Grinch. Shattered Dreams Ministries. The Grinch. Big Fat Meanie Head Ministries. Taking everybody's fun away. All that good stuff. Hey. All right. So here's the thing. I'm going to end this broadcast here. But let me give you a few things here. Number one, exciting things coming in the future here. I will be calling people all over the world. We're going to set up Friday broadcasts in the future here to interview people and to call people all over the world. I'm going to interview, I got to get a hold of some brothers all over the place. I'm going to talk to Brother Ross Duncan about his preaching over in Scotland. He's a street evangelist over there. And I'm going to talk to him about the state of things there. So I'm definitely going to interview him in the future and talk with him and just have a dialogue with him over there. I'm going to talk to Brother Carl over in Croatia, the Croatian sensation. I'm going to talk to him, too, about some things. And he's going to give me a perspective of things in Croatia. And we'll talk about a few things at some point. I'm going to interview that pastor that wrote that book on giants. The one from Texas. I'm going to be talking to him. I've got some other people that I want to talk to. I want to do call-ins. We're going to work on that. A bunch of fun stuff, okay? So hang in there with us. We're looking forward to doing a lot more in the future, okay? And seeing what the Lord allows. If Carl's a good boy, that is. Interview. You want to interview me on the no-ID laws? Do you believe the no-ID laws? Okay, I won't get into that. I did that for like an hour one time with Carl. Anyway. Yeah, I got some people in Canada I'll probably end up talking to, actually. You know, I have a lot of people listening to me in Canada. Maybe it will niggle me if I do not talk to Joe McDonald. So anyway, we'll figure all that out, Lord willing, in the future. Please pray for us. Pray that I get this thing figured out with the septic. Please pray about that. That I get the ignition into my John Deere, because I got that to do. And that I'm able to continue to study for the King James Bible. By the way, if you have not on the King James Bible issue, if you have not listened to this sermon, I'm going to put this on sermon audio. This is an important series. I started it yesterday. And did God preserve his words, battling Bible deniers with the King James? So this is the beginning of this series. I'm going to put it on YouTube probably tomorrow at 6 o'clock sometime. Or no. Yeah, probably 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock I'll put it on. 2 o'clock. At 2 o'clock, I'll put that on, okay? So, definitely want to get that on there so people can listen to that. But pray for me that I can continue to study that issue out. I want to do a very good job, thorough job with teaching our young people and everyone, all of us, about the King James Bible issue. It's for all of us, but I want to ground our young people in the words of God. So the devil can't talk them out of it, and the fowls of the air can't do it either. The devil's little minions, all right? So you pray about that, all right? Pray for the Lord to provide for us and to meet our needs, continue to provide for us. If you'd like to give to our ministry, you can do that through Cash App. I just finally got that working. I don't know what it was, but it works now. So Cash App works. And it's like below zero here, freezing for a whole 10 days, 11 days. We're just below zero in a deep freeze. Cash App works. PayPal works. SalvationPreacher@gmail.com if you want to PayPal us. If you want to mail us something, you can mail us something. Here's our address, 1030 South Highway 3, Northfield, Minnesota, 55057. You can do Venmo. You can do a number of different things. All right? So pray about that. And if it's not you, if God doesn't use you to give, would you pray that God would use somebody else? Because he is well able to do that. Amen? And God answers our prayers. All right. We will continue this. We will continue this on Wednesday. All right? We'll continue that. And you pray for us. And thank